You may have heard that the new highly anticipated view inside of Airtable was recently released. I am talking about the lists view. This type of view is going to make it way easier to handle project management inside of Airtable. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I'm the owner at Gap Consulting, and we've made it our mission to help you get organized and automated with no-code tools, and Airtable is at the forefront of the tools that we use to really streamline all of this operational nonsense that so many of us have to deal with. So, in this video, we're going to be breaking down the Lists view, a brand new view just released from Airtable. We've known that this view was in beta testing for some time, and we've only just now gotten access to it, so I'm excited to jump in. As I mentioned already, the key takeaway for this view is it's going to really help you streamline your project management. So if that's of interest, you are in the right place. Now, before I get going, I want to invite you to join me for my Airtable Crash Course. If you are newer to Airtable and you're still trying to understand why it's so exciting, what's so powerful about it, why does everybody keep talking about it, I'm going to break it all down for you in this Crash Course and teach you all of the key features that you need to know about. So grab that Crash Course at garethpronovost.com/airtable-crash-course. I'll include links below this video, but without further ado, let's hop on into my screen and get going. Here I am on just my Airtable dashboard. I don't even have this built up yet. And so what I'm gonna start with is just a new base from scratch that I'll add to my Gap Consulting workspace. So now here I am, I have my first table. Now, the key takeaway with list view is that it really has to do with the hierarchical representation of data as it reaches through multiple tables in your base. Now, that was a lot of jargon and probably didn't make a ton of sense, but hopefully when you see this in action, it will all click. So let's imagine a scenario where we have projects. I'm just gonna create this particular table of projects. And let's assume I can get rid of all of these fields. I don't need these excess fields. Just hide them for now. But each project, let's say I've got three projects going. Each of these projects is going to link to, let's call them sprints. So the idea here is that a sprint is like a portion of the project, right? Using kind of a scrum type of methodology. So we're gonna create a link to sprints here. I don't have another table yet, so I'm going to create it here with the creation of this field. So I'm creating a new table, I'm calling it sprints, and of course one project can link to multiple sprints. So let's create this field. And now we're gonna see the other side of that. So let's flip into our sprint table. And so we have these different sprints. Let's say that on project one, I needed to add three different sprints. So I would see something like this. So I would add a new field here. Let's call it sprint number. And this would just be a number field. And I can number these sprints 1, 2, 3 within this particular project. With me so far? Now, I'm gonna go ahead and add to the name here, and I'm gonna just concatenate in a formula, and I'm going to combine the pieces of information, both the project and the sprint number. So I'll run a quick concatenate, and I will say project with a dash, and then I will say, inside of these quotes, sprint number. So let's go ahead and drop that in here. And now this formula, once we close it out with that final parenthesis and save it, is going to automatically populate this information for us, the project and the sprint number. So now we can also track additional things on here, like when did this particular sprint begin? What's the start date? Bring in a date field for this, and of course an end date as well. So obviously we can track a lot of different information for this. We could also add the people that are in charge of these different sprints. We can link billable hours to these sprints, etc. For now, let's just fill in some start and end dates. So let's just imagine our sprints are a week long each. So we could say they start on the 8th and on the 15th or 14th. And then we'll come in here for the last one, starts on the 15th and it's gonna end on the 21st. So these are basically week-long sprints that start on, in this case, Wednesday, and then they close on Tuesday of the next week. So far, so good. Now, as I was mentioning, we might want to tie additional information to this. The next layer down on this waterfall, because, you know, we start up with projects, break down to sprints, sprints then lead to billable hours. So I can just create, as we did before, a new link here. Here's billable hours. I'm going to link to another record that exists in a new table that I'm going to create all at once. This table will be called billable hours. And let's go ahead and link. Again, we can link to multiple billable hours per sprint. So we keep this toggled on and we create the field. Now we can flip into the billable hours side of things, and we might want to know who is it that logged this time. So I could use the assignee field type or the user field type here. And so for example, in this case, I myself might come in and log time against one of these sprints. And so I would have to say how much time, and of course this could be done in terms of start and end time, or I could just have one field for this, which is a number field, and here I'm just going to bring in or plug in a number. So I might say I committed 5 hours worth of effort, and I might want to also log the date, and so I could have a date field here as well that says, well, on today's date, the 9th of February, as of this recording, I'm logging 5 hours, not against the project in general, but against that specific sprint within the project. And of course, then I can give this a name as well. And so I might also use a concatenate formula here and bring in just this last piece of information. So I can, again, string together multiple things. Maybe I want to include the user and also add to this the sprint. And lastly, I'll bring in, let's say, the date. And inside of the date, I will actually format that date into a date time format on the date field and just output this in standard format, month, day, year. I know I went fast here. I'm just trying to build the basics of what we need in order to have this thing make sense. So again, here I have the sprint number one, and I should probably add one more dash to make that a little bit cleaner. And I think we should be good to go from here. Let's go ahead and save this up. So now we can see this is the person who logged the time on this particular project, this particular sprint, on this particular day. So of course I might be working over time on this sprint, right? So I would have multiple time entries against this sprint, and I can go ahead and create multiple records here. Let's go ahead and click and drag this on down. And so long as these are all my times, I might have committed 4 hours here, 3 hours here, and 10 hours here on various dates. So let's go ahead and use futuristic dates for logging our time here. So you get the idea. Again, this is a waterfall effect. We start with projects at the high level. Then those projects have multiple sprints related to them. And then we're billing our hours against the sprints in this case. So why does all of this matter? We need this different hierarchy, these different layers or levels in order for this particular view to make any sense whatsoever. So now we can go in at the billable hours perspective and we can set up this new list view. We'll find the view along with all of our other views here on the left-hand side and we can go ahead and put this into effect for ourselves. I'll just call it list view. You can rename it if you'd like. And we're gonna create the view. First thing we're gonna be asked is to add the levels of hierarchy to our list. And that is, of course, the very reason that we built this structure. So, easily show relationships between data across different tables. That's exactly what I want. I've got three different tables, and I want to see all this information in one place if I can. Let's go ahead and try it. We click try it, add our levels of hierarchy, okay. We can also click on through here and see the different examples in this particular setup. But let's get started. So what we now have to do is choose our first level. This should be the most granular level, the lowest level from that hierarchy. So we've started up with projects and drilled down to hours. So we want to start when we build our list view with the smallest piece, which was hours. So we can set that up here, and we can also choose to customize that record name. Let's just stick with record for this example. So that's our most granular level, but now we can start stacking levels on top of that. So we will say add a level above. Now in this case, our next level up from hours was our sprints. And so we're gonna bring in our sprints table, and again, we can change the name here if we so choose. So let's go ahead and use that sprint option here so that it knows that we're actually dealing with sprints here. And then a level above this, of course, is our project level, so let's drill that in, and it already knows that that row should be called a project. So, pretty good start. So that's it for this. Now you'll notice that we have three different available levels at this point. We can't go beyond that, so only three levels can currently be added. Now we're gonna go ahead and hit next and move on to the next screen, and this is where we actually get to establish that relationship. So we need to confirm that this is the field that's going to link to the table in the next level. They automatically fill this out for us because in our example we had it mapped out appropriately, but if you have an issue here, just go ahead and make sure that you have properly identified the field that is going to move you up to that next level in the way that you built that data schema. Maybe you have linked twice or three times to a table, so you'll need to pick the right link that you want to look at here. Now, also note that you can enable nested records for this table. In doing so, if I make that selection, you'll see that there is no current field in my setup for this, but it almost gives you a fourth layer of possibility here. This has to do with linking within itself. So if in this most granular level, these billable hours somehow linked back to themselves, we could add yet another layer to our levels. Doesn't really apply for our example here and gets more complicated. So let's ignore that for now and we'll just go with the three different levels. Now we're going to say next here, and here on this part, we get to choose on this view, we are going to be looking at three different tables all at once, all in one view. So what do we want to bring in to look at for that particular table? So let's say in our project example, we want to see just the project name. We don't care about any of the other data that lives at the project level. But when we get to the sprint level, we want to see the sprint start and end date, as well as maybe the project or sprint. Actually, come to think of it, project and sprint is redundant because we rolled them or concatenated them into the name. So let's leave those out. You'll also notice that you can reorder these things. So if you wanted, for some reason, something to show up before something else, you can just click and drag here and reorder the way it's going to show up on this view. Now for the last one, in our billable hours, we want to be able to see who's the user, what's the actual number, the amount of hours, and what's the date logged for these particular hours. That's it for our setup. Let's click done and actually take a look at what this creates for us in our view. So I'm going to go ahead and zoom into this view, and you see at the highest level that we're looking at the project. So I've just named them project 1, 2, and 3. I can close down project 2, I can close down project 3. Let's just look at project 1, because that's the only one where we've actually added any relevant information. So here I am inside of project 1, and I can then collapse my sprints. So I can break down into my sprints here as well, which is great. If I want to reorder this information, can I sort? Well, I can come up here and say, well, I want to sort my sprints by a particular order. I want to go by sprint number, 1 to 9, or 9 to 1 if you want the biggest sprint up at the top. In making that selection, if I click out of here, you now notice that these have been reordered, 1, 2, and 3. I can drill into the sprint now, all within the same view. Here I am in sprint 1, and I can see the different hours logged. But maybe I want to see these hours in reverse chronological order. That is, the most recently added hour up at the top. So I can go ahead and apply a sort again. Go to the first level, because now I'm looking at the records ordering, and I'm going to go by date, and here I can flip the date around to be reverse chronological order, and again, when I click out of here, we now see that these are sorted appropriately. So the general rules apply, right? We can establish the levels here. We can go in and reorder this, you know, reestablish what we want to look at. We can also customize our rows and determine what we want to have show up on each of these things. And we can filter or sort our data accordingly. As I just demonstrated, you can sort the information as it's being brought in here in terms of what order you want to see things. And you can also filter in or out certain information. So if I only wanted to look at, in this case, project 1, first I would have to say, well, at the project level, I want to add a condition where the name of the project contains the number 1. If I do that, I'm going to remove projects 2 and 3 from my overall view, and I only see all of the data that now relates to project 1, including all of the sprints from project 1. So you get the idea. Just as with any other view in Airtable, we can apply filters and sorts, etc. Now, the real power here, not only do you get to see all of this information in one place, very succinct, and you don't have to click through a lot of things, I can also add records at any of these various levels. If I want to add a new sprint, for example, come down to the bottom here and say add sprint, and it's going to ask me some information. What's the start day? Maybe I start this one on the 22nd, and then it got moved up here. I can set the end date to the 28th, and I can click into this sprint as well. And you'll notice that the fields that are brought up on the original card here, the expanded vision of the record, are just the different fields that we have enabled inside of our view. Of Of course, we can drill in and look at the hidden fields as well. And in this case, one of the hidden fields was the sprint number, so I can add that sprint number to be 4, and we're good to go. You'll notice that I added this sprint inside of this project, and so when I set this up, it already knew that this should be assigned and linked to that particular project, and it did that flawlessly. I can also add records at the other levels as well. So these records here are demonstrating our billable hours. I can come to the bottom of that list, add a new record, assign a user, set a certain number of hours, let's say 6, assign a date here, and this information is going to be appropriately filtered inside of that as well. Now, one thing I've done poorly in this example is actually keep these dates in check, because as I added billable hours, I was billing for stuff that was not within the start and end date of this sprint. So this is a great way that we could also add some additional functionality. Maybe we set up a formula that says, hey, if this date doesn't fall in between these dates, let's add some sort of alert or something to the name of this record that lets you know that you need to give it some extra attention. Now, after watching this, you might find yourself asking, is this offered on my Airtable plan? So flipping on over to Airtable's pricing, you will see that at present, the free, plus, and pro, as well as, of course, enterprise, all of these plans are allowing for the list view. I don't know if that will always be the case, but for now, we can all access list view regardless of what plan we're on. So definitely check it out and start implementing it yourself. One other thing you might find yourself asking is this available inside of interfaces? So if I were to flip back into interfaces and take a quick look, we can go ahead and start building an interface. I'm not too worried about any of this. Let's start with one from scratch with a blank canvas. And if I were to add in, let's see if I can look up list. Sure enough, inside of my elements on Airtable interface, I've got my list. And just as we did previously, we can go ahead and set up all the different hierarchies here with the various levels. So not only is this available to us inside of Airtable natively, inside of the data, but also inside of interfaces, which of course is what we all need in order to help us with our project management so that we can utilize interfaces and limit what people are accessing inside of the database. I know I went fast in this video, so if you have questions that I did not answer, please feel free to drop them below and we will try to reply as soon as possible. Of course, if you haven't already subscribed to this channel and you like to stay on top of no-code news just like this, consider doing so and hitting that little bell so that you know whenever we put out new videos. And in the meantime, keep on building. What's the number of the sprint, or what's the, what is the number of the sprint that I'll add to my gap consulting, the word is workspace. All right.